She's at her half, she's over her half point, you're at your half point, I just cleared my half point.
We're doing good.
What?
Oh, that's, I thought. I thought the participation with the interview came in as a type two.
Oh, what?
One major.
What?
Hi, how are you?
Good, I'm doing good. Do you guys listen?
For real?
How's the internship going?
What?
Good, good, I really like it, I've had the, I think in time we also just talked.
First, does it count as a type two people and ask their opinions of what the work is like?
Does it?
What? Good, good.
Yeah, but I'm also just trying to figure out what.
I wonder if she's actually.
And talk to people about that.
Yeah, did you look at that chapter in the rich book?
I feel like it's like whatever is extra.
VR and journalism.
Oh, yeah.
Just too busy. I did order the class and I think I will get.
Great.
I don't know if I mentioned.
Yeah.
Type two primary resource.
I'm actually able to read it.
Right, need primary resource.
Instead of checking my iPhone before bed, I read, so.
Yes, yeah, it would be a type two.
So we would go by,
if it's been approved as type two or type one, right?
Yeah, but you should have gotten approval by now.
I've sent out emails.
Alright. Yeah, you should be, because you haven't even done your interviews yet.
I have.
You haven't.
I am like, I just, Marissa just said something alarming and I was just like, wait a minute.
Yeah. So the way, usually it goes, what we want to happen is if you're going to do any kind of primer, any kind of interviews, that you get that done in 480 in the fall, so you come into your 490 knowing that you've got IRB approval and you get the interviews done over break or whatever, because now you're going to need to
synthesize.
Kayla went through this too, transcribe them, pull relevant quotes, analyze, right? If you're going to, right? Kayla had an early meeting where a couple of professors were like, how are you analyzing your interviews? So you need to talk to your faculty about that. All right, so it's 12. I got a couple of announcements from Carrie.
Mm-hmm.
She sent us some tasks. There is, first of all, make sure you sign in. So there's an attendance list going around, name and signature. How many of you have scheduled your practice day for your capstone presentation? Okay. Carrie said she was missing. So you've gotten a response from Carrie, you've got a date?
I responded to her, she never responded to me.
Same.
No confirmation yet.
Yeah,
okay,
correct.
Well,
yeah, she hasn't
send her another email that you haven't heard from her. I'll let her know that you responded to the practice presentation email and you didn't get a date.
Yeah,
okay. Okay. Right, so what she's saying is, once you get a practice date.
I was in conversation with her and she said that she was going to figure out the dates once she gets responses from everyone and then send out the confirmation.
Oh, I thought practice days were first come, first served. Really? She's waiting for everyone? That's going to take a while.
Because you're just figuring out your top three.
Okay. So, she usually does that with the actual presentation days. This is practice when you practice an INDS 330 or 480.
Yeah, that's what she told me.
I will clarify that with her. So, make sure everyone has their practice date confirmed. So, presentation days are Tuesday, Wednesday this year. Tuesday, May 1st, Wednesday, May 2nd, 10 a.m. to 2 p.m., not 7th floor of the library. It's going to be in CADVIC, the Center for Art, Design, and Visual Culture, right upstairs here. That's a new thing. So make sure, man, pay attention to emails from INDS, just as a reminder. We're not having presentations in the library this year for like the first time since I've been here. It's in the art gallery, okay? Right, so Tuesday, May 1st, Wednesday, May 2nd, 10 to 2. Did anyone go to the LRC writing workshop? Raise your hand if you found that helpful or if you even attended. It wasn't required. Okay, I see some puzzled looks like, the what? Okay. And then lastly, know that Deb will review drafts of your capstone paper. No one has taken advantage of that yet. But if you want to have an early draft reviewed, send a copy to your faculty mentors and your advisor, your INDS advisor, and we can forward them to Deb. Does that work?
Yeah, that does work. Although I should say, over spring break, I'm going to be out of town, so I won't be looking at anything over spring break. Mm-hmm. But after that, yeah, you can start sending the stuff.
We'll shoot for that. And what's our window for looking at drafts, like after spring break to like mid-April?
Let me think about this for a second. You don't have to, you guys, INDS faculty, don't have to send them all in one fell swoop. It might even be better to get, you know, like them as they come in,
yeah.
Right? And I'll talk a little bit about what I'm going to do at the end of this session.
Okay.
Okay.
All yours, thank you.
Hi, all right, awesome, hello everyone. Welcome back. I guess the first question that I wanted to ask you all is, have any of you actually started drafting your projects yet?
Yes.
How many have started drafting? Any challenges coming up as you're doing the drafting?
Yes. Yeah, the sections have been the hardest part for me. I think it took a while to figure out which section to dive into first that made the most sense for me.
Right.
And then also just like the analysis section, given that it has to be interdisciplinary and we're using these different strategies that have explicit definitions, and then I'm also doing interviewing, I'm also analyzing visual materials and figuring out how to do something that there's no blueprint for.
Right, so you're trying to kind of like wrestle all these disparate parts, sort of like a three-headed monster in some ways. So I guess my advice for that would be, right now, don't necessarily worry about the ordering of those parts, because we're going to talk today about revision and what you're going to be doing in revision. But the main thing right now is just get it all down on paper, right? And you can figure out where things are going to fit later. Like maybe write each one of those sections first, right? And then you'll have them all, and then you can start moving things around during revision. Anyone else? Challenges?
I had similar challenges with Rosa, but I ended up just writing, like, purging onto a paper, and then it just worked out. So it was, like, the intro following into, like, the problematic part, and it was just, like, this is why it's a problem, because it's not interdisciplinary, and then it fed into the interviews of how to address the solution, and then conclusions like that.
Yeah. Yeah, but at the end of this little PowerPoint presentation, there's a quote by some writer, and I can't remember who, whose advice is, vomit on the page in the morning, clean up in the afternoon. So it's kind of good advice. All right, so let's talk about this revision process that you are all going to be entering into shortly once you've got what you think of as a kind of pretty workable first draft, right? All the parts are there, even if they're not completely ordered. So this process of critical revision, again, remember last week we talked about the process of writing, right? So again, we're still talking about process, and I came across this somewhere, I don't remember where, but the idea is you're drafting as the child. You're in the moment, trying out ideas, having fun, open to any option, no goal in mind, although obviously you guys have something of a goal. So in Freudian terms, kind of the id, the creative id, you're just getting everything out there. You're going to revise as the adult. You're going to ask yourself, what's this really about? Who's going to read this? What do they need to know? Kind of, you know, very kind of focused, direct thinking. And again, in Freudian terms, kind of the ego. Last stage, the parent, or the teacher. Is every sentence polished, crisp, and exactly what I want to say? Sort of the Freudian superego, right? So again, referring back to that issue we were discussing before, don't be trying to look at your draft as kind of the ego or the superego. Have fun with it, play with it, just get it all down. Now, when you finally get to the point where you do have an actual draft, and are going to start doing revision, it's very important to keep in mind that there's a difference between copy editing, which is kind of the last phase of the process, kind of minor adjustments, checking punctuation, replacing words for greater clarity, and revision, which is a much deeper process, right? Because here you're reconsidering each and every element, you know, in each section. Nothing is going to remain unless it serves the purpose of the piece taking place on the stage. On the page, rather. A good way to think about this is in terms of, you know, I don't know if any of you are kind of interested in decorating or redecorating. So copy editing is kind of, you know, like maybe getting a new lamp or, you know, maybe new paintings and adding little things. Revision is more like you're redoing the whole room. You know, you're maybe tearing down walls, maybe you're painting. It's, you know, kind of structural as well as decorative. So what's the stepwise approach to revision? The first thing you want to do when you're going back and first looking at your draft after you've walked away for a while is look at the big picture. Have I fulfilled my purpose in writing this thing? And does this thing address the specific audiences? Remember last time we talked about audiences? So are you going to reach those audiences with audience or audiences with what you've written thus far? The next step is you kind of want to look, again, this is kind of big picture, but focusing on sort of the development of your ideas throughout the piece. Does the main idea have enough supporting material? Secondly, does that supporting material relate logically to the main idea? Or are you just throwing it in there because it's something you came across in your research and you thought was cool? It's really important to build a sound structure. You know, think about it in terms of architecture and design and building. If the structure isn't sound, you're in trouble. So when we're talking about structure in terms of writing, A, first thing, you want to make sure, you know, that first sentence, the most important sentence in any piece of writing is the first one, because if it doesn't persuade the reader to proceed to the second sentence, the article or the piece is dead. Obviously, you guys have kind of a captive audience in terms of your faculty mentors. But even so, you know, as we talked about last time, you want them to be excited about reading this piece. So draw them in from the start. Nextly, each paragraph should amplify the one that precedes it and take special care with the last sentence of each paragraph. Why? Because it's the springboard to the next paragraph. So be sure that you link the last sentence of the paragraph with the first sentence of the next by repeating a word or phrase or elaborating on a concept. Something to keep in mind is the end part of a sentence or a paragraph is the part where you want the emphasis to be. Step three, is there a structure? Is there a controlling idea that can be traced through the writing? Does that first paragraph create interest and focus? Do the individual paragraphs link to the controlling idea? And does the ending of the piece as a whole provide a sense of closure? Now, one thing that you might want to do while you are looking at the structural elements of your thesis is actually go back to the old-fashioned way of print the whole thing out. Don't try to do this on the computer. And actually cut. You know, we do cut and paste on a computer. Do this physically. So cut each section or each paragraph and start moving the parts around, like lay them all out on a big table like this. Because this is going to help you sort of visualize structure, right? You know, you were saying, you know, you don't know where all the separate parts are going to go. Move them around. See how they look. You can do this on the computer, but it's actually really helpful to do it physically and play with it a little bit. So once you've actually gotten what you think of, and if you're also going to notice if there are gaps, if there are pieces missing, whether that's information or concepts or whatever when you're doing that. So then you can just kind of like take a blank piece of paper and scribble on that whatever section is missing, whatever information you need, and put that in the midst of that structure that you're building. Once you feel like you've got the structure down, then it's time to start looking at sentences. Are the sentences clear? Does the word order in sentences seem logical? Are verbs usually in active voice, not passive voice? More on that later, we're gonna do a little worksheet. And finally, does your diction or word choice seem sensible and effective for the purpose and the audience? Again, I'll pass this slideshow along to Carrie so that she can share it with you. So remember last time around I said you should buy this book, The Elements of Style by Strunk and White? I hope you bought it or are considering buying it, but even if you don't, memorize this paragraph because it kind of boils the whole book down into a single paragraph. Vigorous writing is concise. A sentence should contain no unnecessary words, a paragraph no unnecessary sentences, for the same reason that a drawing should have no unnecessary lines and a machine no unnecessary parts. This requires not that the writer make all sentences short or avoid all detail and treat subjects only in outline, but that he makes every word tell, or she makes every word tell, right? So what in your sentences, you just want the necessary number of words to express the meaning of that sentence without a lot of extra falderal. Similarly with paragraphs. One of the things that I find is, you guys are seniors, so maybe you've kind of outgrown this, but a lot of times, particularly in freshmen and sophomore year at university, a lot of students have kind of been writing toward a specific page count or word count in their academic writing over the years. That leads to the very bad habit of just kind of throwing in a lot of extra words, and this even goes beyond, you know, the old tricks of changing the font size or that sort of thing, but it's just throwing in a lot of unnecessary words in order to meet that word count or page count, and you really need to kind of break that habit if you want to write clearly and concisely. Here's another quote by Zinsser, who wrote another great book on writing. The secret of good writing is to strip every sentence to its cleanest components. Every word that serves no function, every long word that could be a short word, every adverb that carries the same meaning that's already in the verb, every passive construction that leaves the reader unsure who is doing what, all those weaken the strength of a sentence. So you're seeing a kind of theme here, right? In order to make your prose as clear and transparent as possible, in order to call attention to your thoughts and ideas, you need to strip your language of all this unnecessary junk. So Zinsser is particularly hard on what he calls clutter, the laborious phrase which has pushed out the short word that means the same thing. Another writing instructor who has published a really good book that I use in my science writing class calls these wordy clumps, right? Clutter is like a ponderous euphemism. It's the language of the American corporation, the interoffice memo. Clutter is weedy phrases like, I might add, I should point out, it's interesting to note, right? You don't need that stuff. Prune them. Your goal is to write very tightly, replacing adjectives and adverbs with strong nouns and verbs, using direct form of verbs, using short, punchy Anglo-Saxon words rather than these sort of long, Latinate constructions, and really, and we talked about this a little bit the last time, avoiding jargon, fad words, and business lingo. This, again, you can tattoo this on your hand, omit needless words. And eliminate redundancy, saying the same thing in a different way, maybe in succeeding paragraphs. What's jargon? Special words or expressions that are used by a particular profession or group and are difficult for others to understand. I believe we touched on this the last time. Some of you said, well, I need to use certain specialized language. That's fine. Make sure that you define it the first time you use it. But whenever possible, if you can, eliminate that jargon and sort of translate the concept into everyday language without doing damage to what you're trying to express, do that. And this relates to audience, because as we talked about, all of you, your audiences are not going to be people who are sort of professionals in, have an interdisciplinary audience, in other words. So all of them are not going to be familiar with each other's jargon. I said translate jargon into everyday English. Ah, here's a biggie. Active versus passive voice, right? What is sentence structure in active voice? It's a subject, it's a verb, and it's an object. If the subject performs the action, that sentence is in active voice. The train, subject, struck the truck, verb, object. If the subject receives the action, the sentence is in passive voice. The truck was struck by the train. Now those are pretty simple sentences, right? And you can sort of figure out what's going on even when it's in passive voice. But the greater the complexity of the information that you're trying to convey, the more passive voice causes the reader to be incredibly confused. If you're writing a long, complex sentence in passive voice, the reader's gonna have to stop and be like, what is really going on here, right? So active voice is almost always the better choice. And again, we're gonna do a little active-passive voice exercise. So why? Why do writing instructors, you know, talk about the need for active voice? First, because it's more direct, economical, and honest. It's more considerate of readers. They don't have to search through the sentence to figure out who is doing what. Passive voice is very common in scientific and business communication, but if you're writing for a general audience, you should stick to active voice. Even in science writing, scientific papers, passive voice, which has kind of long been the standard, is slowly giving way in many cases to more active voice. Anybody know when you can get away with using passive voice, when passive voice is okay? Any ideas?
Writing grievance letters.
I don't know, I've never written a grievance letter. That's an idea though. But it's when the object is more important than the subject, right? For example, let's say a very famous painting was stolen from the Metropolitan Museum. then the object, the painting that was stolen, is clearly more important than who stole the painting or whatever. So in that case, it would be okay to write a sentence saying, yesterday, I don't know, Rembrandt's, blanking on what a famous Rembrandt painting is, was stolen from the Metropolitan Museum in New York City, right? Similarly, this is why passive voice is so common in science writing, right? Because it's not so important who's doing what, but what's being done. All right, let's talk about long sentences. There are pretty much three kinds of longish sentences. One is a compound sentence, which is two complete sentences joined by a conjunction, like and, but, for, nor, yet. A complex sentence, which contains at least one clause that acts as an assistant to the main part of the sentence, right? Sometimes separated by a semicolon, but not necessarily. And a run-on sentence is two complete sentences, which have a subject, a verb, and an object, that run together without a period. Now, which one of those three is something that you should be on the lookout for and always fix? The run-on sentence. Absolutely. Right? What's the fix there?
Period.
A period, right? So dividing it into two separate sentences. What about these complex and compound sentences? Are they okay? Sometimes, not always, right? You're going to just have to take a look at those individual sentences and see if they would be better split into two sentences. An old rule in science writing, the more complex the explanation or the description, the shorter sentences should be, right? Because when you're trying to explain something that's really complicated, it helps to break it down into parts rather than trying to throw it all into one sentence. Here's what I just said. You should always ask, do I really need this word, phrase, clause? If yes, keep it. When in doubt, cut or rewrite the sentence and eliminate all run-on sentences. So parallel structure. When you're trying to sort of convey a list concept in a sentence or in a paragraph, parallel structure means using the same pattern of words to show that two or more ideas have the same level of importance. I'll show you an example in a minute. So you can use parallel structure at either the word, the phrase, or the clause level, and the usual way to join parallel structures is with the use of commas or coordinating conjunctions, such as and or. Sometimes we call this the rule of three, because usually when you're using parallel structure, you use kind of three examples. Mary likes hiking, swimming, and bicycling. The manager wrote the report quickly, accurately, and thoroughly. The teacher said he was a poor student because he waited until the last minute to study for the exam, completed his lab problems in a careless manner, and lacked motivation. And that last example, can you see that the structure of each one of those clauses is the same? Starts with a verb, waited until the last minute to study for an exam, completed, lacked motivation, right? It makes it easier to read, yeah.
What is your opinion on Oxford commas?
In general, I'm anti-Oxford comma. But, you know, there is a debate about the Oxford comma.
But it, like, rule of thumb, I can choose whether I put it.
I think so. Okay. I tend not to use them, except in rare instances, but, you know, some people are like, yeah, they're absolutely necessary.
I love the Oxford.
I'm agnostic on that point. I would say do what feels right to you. Agreements and antecedents. Be sure that nouns and verbs agree in number, meaning, you know, if you're using singular, use singular all the way through the sentence, plural, plural. And again, this is something that we're going to do a quick little worksheet on. Be sure that participial phrases and modifiers at the beginning of a sentence refer to the subject of the sentence. Unintentionally comic constructions result when writers violate this rule. Let me give you a really quick example even before we get to the... Here's a couple of examples of misplaced modifiers. Lighting a cigarette, comma, a small prop plane passed overhead. What's wrong with that sentence? What do you think? Lighting a cigarette, a small prop plane passed overhead.
Cigarette.
Yeah, the plane is not lighting the cigarette, right? It's ridiculous, and it's going to make people laugh if you're not paying attention to these things. Here's another example. Turning the corner, comma, the jackhammer grew louder and louder until we were hit by a shattering crescendo. What's the problem with that sentence? turning the corner, the jackhammer grew louder and louder until we were hit by a shattering crescendo.
The jackhammer doesn't turn the corner.
No, the jackhammer's not turning the corner, right? The people are turning the corner. So we're going to look at a few more of these just to sort of have this on your radar, because I do encounter this in student writing more often than you would expect. So be very direct in your language, avoid parenthetical phrases and weasel words that dilute the meaning of the sentence, like a little, relatively, seems to, around, kind of, sort of, probably, a tad, honestly, comma, blah, 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 truth to tell, comma, to be fair, granted. These are all words that sort of dilute the strength of the idea that you're trying to express in the sentence and can usually just be X'd out. So a few other things to think about when you're revising at the sentence level: use forceful verbs. If you use really strong, active, forceful verbs, you don't need adverbs to modify them. Look for places where you've used the same word twice or more in consecutive sentences. And I'm not talking about things like an and the, right? But substitute alternatives or combine the sentences. Thirdly, cut adjectives and adverbs, use strong nouns and verbs instead, then you won't need those modifiers. Look at the length of your sentences. You know, you might assume that based on everything that I've been saying, I'm saying all sentences should be only 5 words long. Not necessarily. You kind of want to vary the length of your sentences in order to make writing a little bit more interesting. And finally, look for those diagonal modifiers. Here's a big one. Look for sentences that start with it is, there are, or there are, and see if you can revise them to be more active and engaging. This is something that I've noticed a lot of when I've been reading some of these in previous years' IND theses. That's fine in a first draft, but when you go back, try to restructure the sentence to get rid of those phrases. And finally, aim for precise diction. Diction is word choice, right? Have any of you ever heard of the 19th century novelist Gustave Flaubert? He wrote Madame Bovary and other things. So Flaubert wrote about and talked with friends about finding le mot juste, which is the right word, right? And there's also a famous quote from the American writer Mark Twain: the difference between the almost right word and the right word is a large matter. It's the difference between the lightning bug and the lightning, right? So always, you know, when you're going back and you're hopefully multiple revisions, be looking for the right word. These are rules of writing by George Orwell. Have any of you read Orwell? Mm-hmm. Yeah. So one of his most famous essays is called Politics and the English Language. It's a great essay, and if you haven't read it yet, you should go read it, especially in this world we're living in now, because he talks about the way that language can be used to obscure truth and to manipulate people. But these are the rules Orwell laid down in that essay. Never use a metaphor, simile, or other figure of speech, which you're used to seeing in print. What do we call those things?
Alternative
facts. But also, here's a word from your probably middle school English: cliches, right? Never use a long word where a short one will do. If it's possible to cut a word out, always cut it out. Never use the passive voice when you can use the active. Never use a foreign phrase, a scientific word, or a jargon word if you can think of an everyday English equivalent. And finally, this is my favorite, break any of these rules sooner than say anything outright barbarous. So that one kind of goes back to the old saw. You can break the rules in writing, but first know the rules, right? So that then you're consciously breaking them rather than breaking them without knowing what you're doing. So a final check: check the length of paragraphs, check the transitions between paragraphs so you're smoothly transitioning from one to the other. That doesn't have to be by using a word like however. We talked the last time about sort of using a word, repeating a word or a concept to link between sentences and between paragraphs. Clearly, check your spelling and punctuation, right? That's pretty basic. Delete meaningless words, delete redundancies, which are repeated words, confirm subject-verb agreement and subject-pronoun agreement. I believe these we've already talked about earlier. Oh, read backward. Right? Read the sentences backward, because you're more likely to notice typos, spelling errors, and stray punctuation. read your work aloud to yourself, because if you stumble over a phrase or a sentence or a paragraph, you're going to notice it more if you're reading it aloud than if you're reading it on the page. And also read your work aloud to others, because they're going to point out to you things that are unclear or awkward. So here are some good quotes to end up, what some great writers had to say about this process of revision. First, Twain, the time to begin writing an article is when you finished it. Seems kind of counterintuitive, right? But as Twain says, by that time you've begun to clearly and logically perceive what it is that you really want to say. Any of you ever had the experience that you don't know what you're thinking about some subject until you write about it? Mm-hmm. I know it's certainly true for me. Stephen King, the horror novelist, says the formula equals the second draft should be 10% shorter than the first draft. Why? Because of this process of paring down. And finally, knowing what you want to say and saying it more clearly. The 18th century English essayist Samuel Johnson says, read over your compositions, and when you meet a passage which you think is particularly fine, strike it out. Another way of saying that is kill your darlings. If there's some phrase that you are particularly in love with, you probably need to get rid of it. Why?
Because it only pertains to you, and it's not just not a message received by others.
Possibly. And also, it's probably a sign that you're showing off. Right? You're calling attention to the language rather than to the ideas expressed by the language. Kurt Vonnegut said, your eloquence should be the servant of the ideas in your head. Another way of saying language should serve ideas. Your rule might be this: if a sentence, no matter how excellent, does not illuminate your subject in some new and useful way, scratch it out. So you're seeing, like, all of these people are saying pretty much the same thing, right? Here's the quote that I was referring to. Throw open your typewriter every morning, clean up every noon, by Raymond Chandler, the famous detective novelist. John Updike, writing and rewriting are a constant search for what it is one is saying or trying to say. Children's novelists, we're all dull. By the time I'm nearing the end of a story, the first part will have been reread and altered and corrected at least 150 times. I'm suspicious of both facility and speed. Good writing is essentially rewriting. Absolutely true. I think I quoted to you in our first meeting, if something is easy to read, that means it was really hard to write. And by write, I don't just mean draft. I mean also this continuous process of revision. You know, professional writers revise more than anyone, right? And here's the last one. Neil Gaiman, the fantasy novelist. Yeah. The best advice I can give on this is, once it's done, to put it away until you can read it with new eyes. Finish the short story, print it out, put it in a drawer and write other things. When you're ready, pick it up and read it as if you've never read it before. If there are things you aren't satisfied with as a reader, go in and fix them as a writer. That's revision. So that applies to nonfiction as well, right? Once you've finished your draft, walk away from it for a little while. I don't know what your time frame is, but it's always good to leave it for at least a day or a couple of days if you can. Maybe you can even afford to leave it for a week. Why? Because when you go back and look at it again, it's going to look new to you, and it's going to be easier to see what's wrong than it will be when you've just finished it. And again, in your successive revising of this document, always try to build in a little time that you can step away from the manuscript for a longer or shorter period of time before returning to it again. Final advice, what I told you last week, expect a lousy first draft, right? When you look at those first drafts, you're going to be like, this sucks. How can I turn this in? That's fine. They're supposed to be bad. And every writer's first drafts are far from what they're going to look like at the end. Bad sentences are not a problem unless they're on the page when the work is finished, right? Because you can always go back and change them. The key to handling bad days and bad sentences is to love revision, right? Personally, I've kind of gotten to the point where I enjoy revision. It takes the pressure off when writing the first draft. And the process of revision is not nearly as arduous than that just getting your ideas down on the page, which I think is the hard part. So we have about almost a half an hour, so I'm thinking that what we should do now is do some exercises that are really going to clarify a couple of these sentence level issues. I mean, when I, generally in classes, when I talk about the difference between passive and active voice, people are like, oh yeah, I know what that is. And then they are like looking at their sentences and they're like, maybe I really don't know what that is. So apart from these exercises, don't worry about it. One of the things you should absolutely do when you're going back and revising your first draft after you've gotten the structure done is go through them with a highlighter, highlight every single verb in the piece. Why? Because you're looking to make sure it's in active voice, and if it's in passive voice, you want to convert it. You also want to make sure that it's a strong active verb, and that's going to be the subject of these first couple of exercises. We're going to be going this way. Now these are very simple sentence, you know, they're not expressing, can you pass this to those guys right there? Complex ideas. But that's good because they're gonna help us to actually see what we're doing. So how about let's do the first five. Edit or rewrite these sentences, changing from passive to active voice. So, let's say this is going to take us about 5 minutes. And then we'll go through them together.
All of them?
Just the first five.
Okay.
And just put your hand up when you've finished with them so I know. Ready? All right, first one. The suspects were arrested by the California Highway Patrol officers. Ready? That's passive voice.
I've got part B.
Oh, that's right. We're going to go do that next. What do you think, guys? How do you make that active voice? Yes.
the California Highway Patrol officers arrested
the suspects. Exactly. Okay. The Oscars were provided by the Academy of Motion Pictures Arts and Sciences. Yep.
The Academy of Motion Pictures Arts and Sciences provided the Oscars.
Correct. Number three, the report concluded that perhaps $10 billion a year is added to the U.S. economy by immigrants, legal and illegal. Yes?
The report concluded that immigrants, legal and illegal, add $10 billion a year to the U.S. economy.
Correct. And I would even say immigrants, legal and illegal, add perhaps $10 billion a year to the U.S. economy, according to the report, right? To really highlight that subject, which is the immigrants, legal and illegal. What about number four? This is a sticky sentence. It would be illegal and unfair for welfare recipients to be forced to work for less than the minimum wage, according to labor unions and advocates for the poor. Thinking back to what I was saying before about how passive voice makes the reader have to stop and think about what's just going on. How many of you had that reaction to this sentence? Like, what exactly is happening in the sentence? Who is doing what? Who has a good revision?
Just flip it.
All right, so you could start with according to labor unions and advocates for the poor, then how would you flip and make active the first part of the sentence?
Recipients would be forced to work for less than minimum wage.
Anyone want to give us a whole sentence revision?
I'm really bad at active voice.
Well, it's good that you know it. So it's something that you're aware of. So.
It's a weakness of mine.
Okay. So anybody? Go ahead.
Just really, according to labor unions and advocates for the poor, to work for less than minimum wage would be illegal and unfair for welfare recipients.
But if welfare recipients is kind of the subject there, according to labor unions and advocates for the poor, or welfare recipients should not be forced to work for less than the minimum wage, right?
Oh, so
that
you can
clarify.
Just get rid of illegal and unfair.
Or you could add that, but make welfare recipients the subject of the clause. And let's do one more. A soul-infused tone was set by the singer for the evening. Yep.
The singer set a soul-infused tone for the evening.
Absolutely. Okay. So we won't do all of them now, but do highlight the verbs in your thesis when you're to the point of being ready to look at sentence structure and sort of carefully ask yourself, is this an active voice or passive voice, and how do I flip it to put it into active voice? All right, flip the paper to the other side. Here we're talking about being verbs and converting being verbs to action verbs. And the reason that we convert being verbs to action verbs is because it makes the sentence more focused and direct. Being verbs are sort of almost, they need to be used sometimes, but for the most part, you want to go for a really strong active verb. So look at the first five examples there, and let's try to flip them and get rid of the is, has. Helping verb. Yes. Oh, sorry.
I don't have a back.
You don't have a back?
I have your back.
Sorry about that. You know what? I probably gave you guys the original copy that that I had put on two sides. You're ahead of the game because you've already done this part. just about ready. All right, how about number one? The president said he is hopeful the talks will lead to an accord. Remember, you're getting rid of the being verb. Yeah?
And then the president said he hopes the talks will lead
yes,
to an accord.
Yes, rather than he is hopeful, he hopes. How about number two? Privately, officials say they are doubtful that the two sides will ever get together. Yeah?
Privately, officials doubt that the two sides will get together.
Absolutely. She has been a teacher for 14 years. She has taught for 14 years, right? You're making the verb active. The blood bank is in need of more donations, especially of O negative. To get rid of the being verb, the blood bank does what?
Needs.
Needs. The blood bank needs more donations. He is the self-proclaimed first citizen of the new regime.
I said he claims.
You could say he claims, or he proclaimed himself first citizen of the new regime, right? You see how using the active verb makes the sentence punchier, because somebody is doing something, right? Maybe we'll do the last five of these, but I don't want to run out of time to talk about the other two things, which are the really fun one, the misplaced modifiers, which you'll get a laugh out of. Can you pass those two backwards, please? And on the back, getting rid of wordiness. So how about here? Let's go for the harder sentences with the misplaced modifiers. Let's do the last five sentences, 6 through 10. Actually, B.
Okay.
Yeah. A is wordiness, right? So the last five sentences under B, misplaced modifiers. Remember, this is where the second clause doesn't agree with the first. These are hard or no? All right, let's do them together then. All right, number six. Once defrosted, we added pumpkin. We add pumpkin to the other ingredients. What's wrong there?
It sounds like they are getting defrosted.
Exactly. So how would you fix that?
Once the pumpkin is defrosted.
Yes.
Yes.
Right. It's kind of a funny sentence as it is, because it makes it sound as though the people are the ones who are being defrosted. All right, how about the late Carl Sagan began researching the origins of life in the 1960s? Don't think about changing it for a second. First, figure out what's wrong with that sentence. The late Carl Sagan began researching the origins of life in the 1960s.
Yeah.
It sounds like he's researching the life in the 1960s and not...
Well, it sounds like the origins of life happened in the 1960s, right? So how would you fix that?
In the 1960s, late Carl Sagan began researching the origins of life.
Perfect. How about number eight? While touring the Louvre, the paintings of several French impressionists came into his view. What's wrong there? Who's touring the Louvre? So while he was touring the Louvre, either I would change it to he saw the paintings of several French impressionists to make it more clear, right? So that first clause kind of lacks a subject. How about number nine? U.S. Senator Mitch McConnell pledged to fight campaign finance reform during his campaign. What's wrong with that sentence?
It sounds like during his campaign he's trying to fight campaign reform.
Yeah, so how would you fix it?
During his campaign, the senator pledged to fight campaign finance reform.
Very good. What about number 10? What's wrong with that sentence? Look at the last phrase.
We can't tell if he stayed there until 1948 or if the jazz organization was the greatest.
Considered the greatest till 1948, yes. So some of these, it's really easy to identify the misplaced modifier. Other, it's a lot harder, right? This writing business is harder than it looks, isn't it? So in addition to highlighting all your verbs and checking to make sure that they are in active voice and also that they're kind of as strong as they can be. Also, just cast an eye over to look to see if you have any of these misplaced modifiers, because I do encounter these on a pretty regular basis in student work. It's easy to do. You know, like, none of these things are mortal sins. When you're trying to get your ideas down on the page, it's, you know, pretty likely that some of this stuff is going to slip in, but when push comes to shove, you certainly don't want it to appear in your final draft if you can avoid it at all. So I don't think we're really going to have time to do the last exercise, which if you flip your pages, wordiness, editing, and rewriting these sentences to eliminate unneeded words. But in some ways, this one is probably going to be the most relevant to the work that you're doing in these theses, because I'll bet you, to use a cliche, dollars to donuts, you're gonna come across a lot of long wordy clumps like the one you see in these sentences. So it might be worth your while at some point when you're just sitting around trying to figure out if you're gonna watch a Netflix movie or do something, just practice with these sentences. See if you can edit or rewrite them to make them much more clear and direct and get rid of unnecessary words. As Zinsser says, eliminate the clutter. As Strunk and White said, make sure the sentence has no unnecessary words that don't need to be there. Because if you do that with these kind of simple sentences, it's going to be easier for you to recognize when you're doing the same thing in your work and just sort of make your writing a lot more clear and concise. Any questions about anything we discussed today? So what are you going to do with your drafts once you get to the point where you're happy with your structure? After you cut the piece up and into different paragraphs and moved them all around and added little scraps of paper saying what you have to add and you're happy with the structure, next you're going to go in and do what? Once you got the structure down? Well, that's part of revision, but the next part of revision is looking at the individual paragraphs to see if every sentence in that paragraph should be there and does what it needs to be doing. Once you're happy with the structure and the individual paragraphs, what's the next level? The sentences, right? So So it really is like the reverse process of building the house, right? All right, good luck. I will be excited and happy to read your drafts when you're ready to send them. As I said, you all don't have to send them at once. You can send them when you're happy with your first draft. The only thing I ask is that you don't all wait until like the very end of the semester to send them, because that's going to create a time crunch for me. Okay? Good luck, guys.
Do you want to take them now?
I can take them now.